Seriously? What? You're Italian and you work in an Italian restaurant, but you haven't done any Italian dishes yet. Shameful. I know, right? I'm fixing that right now, though. Roll the f***ing tape. Today we're going to be making pasta carbonara, a dish that's frequently bastardized and thus misconceptualized with cream. This is the no bullshit traditional version, so leave your cream in the fridge. Carbonara, in its most traditional form, is made with guanciale, or cured pork jowl. Sounds weird, right? Wrong. This stuff has a strong flavor, but in the right application, such as this one, it's damn delicious. A frequent substitute, and what I'm using here, since guanciale can be hard to find sometimes, is pancetta, which is essentially Italian bacon. And of course, what most people are probably familiar with is just regular bacon. While I wholeheartedly recommend using one of the first two, I understand that bacon is oftentimes more accessible, and balling on a budget is better than not balling at all. So have at it, if that's all you can use. Oh, and if you'd like to forego meat entirely, mushrooms are a solid substitute here. Start out by dicing 4 ounces of your meat into roughly quarter inch squares. This stuff is dense and fatty, and can feel kinda awkward to work with in contrast to the stuff you're used to cutting like vegetables, so take your time and work carefully. The last thing you want to do is f*** yourself up in the first stage of cooking. Set that aside and move on to your sauce. Carbonara sauce is typically made with Pecorino Romano cheese, though substituting Parmigiano Reggiano is fairly common and perfectly acceptable. I don't particularly care which one you use, just please, for the love of God, spring for a block of the real stuff, not that pre-grated sawdust bullshit that barely even qualifies as cheese. The difference when you grate it yourself is more than noticeable. Anyway, grate 4 ounces of cheese and get your eggs out of the fridge. But Launchpad, you said we were going to make the sauce, and then you told me to grate cheese and get the eggs. What the f*** are you on about? Chill, homie, this is the sauce. Carbonara sauce is cheese and eggs. You know, the two food groups. It sounds weird, but just trust me, okay? Now, when cracking your eggs, make sure that you crack them in such a way that the shell breaks awkwardly, so that you look like a f***ing amateur that can't even break an egg properly. Build on this look by accidentally separating your white into the mixture instead of the trash can. Then remember who the f*** you are and do it the right way. At any rate, you need 3 whole eggs and 1 egg yolk. As a side note, you've probably seen a lot of people separate egg yolks by moving the egg back and forth between the shell halves. This method can result in your egg yolk breaking prematurely, which can be pretty messy, and it relies on your egg breaking cleanly, which as I've just expertly demonstrated is not always the case. Instead, pour the egg into your hand and allow the white to fall between your fingers as you roll it between your hands. Just make sure you don't obstruct the shot with your measuring cup like an idiot. Now give your eggs a good whisk, a hearty whisk, an aggressive whisk. Whisk your eggs until there are no streaks left in them, then add your cheese and mix until everything is fully incorporated. Finally, add in some fresh ground black pepper. I can actually say to use a metric ton of black pepper and not be ridiculous here. Carbonara calls for a considerable amount of the stuff. Okay, so I didn't actually measure out how much I used, and I apologize for that, but I did turn the pepper mill 32 times. Okay, so I googled it, and it turns out that one turn on a pepper mill roughly equates to a quarter teaspoon. So 32 turns is a little more than half a tablespoon, or 1.5 teaspoons. P.S. 1 tablespoon is 3 teaspoons. That knowledge could save your life someday. Go ahead and get a pot of water going on the stove for your pasta, and be sure to salt it heavily. Not to lower the boiling point, because that doesn't actually work unless you get it to seawater salinity, but because it will flavor the pasta. At the same time, set up another pot, or a large deep sauté pan, over medium-high heat, and add a touch of oil. Allow it to get hot, and add whatever meat you're using. Cook for 5 to 7 minutes, allowing the fat to render and the meat to crisp up, and stir occasionally. Remove the meat from the pan, but leave the oil. Now that your water is boiling, add a half pound of long, string-type pasta, such as spaghetti, bucatini, or in my case, linguine. Just don't break it in half. This is sacrilege to an Italian, and if you do, I swear to God I will come to your house while you're sleeping and move all of your furniture 2 inches to the left, take the batteries from your remotes, and tilt everything hanging on your walls. Do not f*** with me. Anyway, cook your pasta until it's al dente, which translates to the tooth. Basically, your pasta needs to still have a little bit of chewiness to it. The secret age-old Italian trick to knowing this? Take a noodle out and eat it. Revolutionary, I know. But since you probably still have a few minutes before your pasta is done, why don't you do us both a favor and hit those thumbs up and subscribe buttons if you haven't already. Now that your pasta is sufficiently toothy, reserve some of the pasta water and drain out the rest. Using the pasta water will help thin out the sauce when it's mixed in, and the starchiness of it will help keep it all together. For this next step, I'm going to need you to move quickly and confidently, as this part requires a little bit of finesse. Add the noodles to the pan you cook the meat in, along with a splash of water. Pour the eggy cheese mix in and stir vigorously. The heat of the pasta and the pasta water is what will actually be cooking the eggs, and it needs to stay moving as they cook, or you'll end up with scrambled eggs. Don't fret though, it's not as hard as it sounds. You can do this. If your sauce seems too thick, you can add a little bit more of the water, and if it seems too thin, you can thicken it up with a little bit more cheese. Looking back, I could have added a touch more of the water to mine, but that's okay. The finished product still tasted great. Return the meat to the pan and get ready to plate up. You can absolutely just throw this stuff on a plate with some tongs and devour it, but if you want to feel classy and get a food picture worthy of an Instagram post, use a carving fork to swirl up a towering coil of pasta and dot the exterior with a couple pieces of the meat. Finish it up by hitting the plate with a little more fresh grated cheese and enjoy.
Yeah, you should totally play it if you hate yourself and you never want to be happy again. It's really good for that. If you just want to be...